So we argued that we would like to measure efficiency of an algorithm in terms of basic operations, and we would like to compute the running time of an algorithm in terms of a function of its input size n. And we also saw that if you go from say n squared to n log n, then the size of inputs you can effectively handle becomes dramatically larger. Now today we will try to formalize some of these notions a little more clearly. So the first thing is the input size, right? So remember that the running time of an algorithm will necessarily depend on the size of the input. So we want to write the running time as some function t of n. And the main thing to remember is that not all inputs of size n will give the same running time. So there is going to be a notion of worst case estimate, which we will need to explain and justify. Before we do this, let's look at the notion of input size itself. How do we determine the input size for a given problem? So the input size more or less represents the amount of space it takes to write down the description of the problem, or in terms of the natural parameter of the problem. So for instance, when we are sorting arrays, what really matters is how many objects there are to sort, because we have to move them around and rearrange them. So the size of an array is quite a natural notion of input size for a sorting problem. On the other hand, if we are trying to do something like rearranging elements, or take, say, we have some items which we need to load into a container and we are looking for an optimum subset to load in terms of weight or volume, then the number of objects would be a natural input parameter. We saw in one of the early lectures an example of air travel, where we constructed a graph of an airline route map where the nodes were the cities and the edges were the flights. And we argued that both the number of cities and the number of flights will have an impact on any analysis we need to do. So this is a general property of all graphs. If we have a graph, then both the number of nodes or vertices and the number of edges will determine the input size. Now there is an important class of problems where we have to be a little bit careful about how we talk about input size, and these are problems involving numbers. Suppose we were to write an algorithm for primality, checking whether a given number is prime. Now, how should we think of the size of the input? For instance, suppose we ask it to solve the question for say 5003, and then for 50003, then 50003 is roughly 10 times 5003. So would we expect the time to grow proportional to 10? So should the magnitude of n actually be taken as the input size? Now, it's quite obvious when we do arithmetic by hand, the kind of arithmetic we do in school, that we don't go by magnitude, we go by the number of digits. When we do arithmetic such as addition with carry, we write down the numbers in columns and then we add them column by column. So the number of digits determines how many columns we have to add. The same is true with subtraction or addition or multiplication or long division and so on. Okay? So clearly it's the number of digits which matters, and the number of digits is actually the same as the log. If we have numbers written in base 10, then if we have a 6-digit number, its log is going to be 5 point something. Okay? When we get to logs 6, we will have a 7-digit number and so on. So the number of digits is directly proportional to the log, and so we can think of the log of the number as the input size. So this is a special case. So for arithmetic functions involving numbers, it is not the number itself which is the input size, but the size of the number as expressed in how many digits it takes us to write down the number. Now the other thing we mentioned is that we are going to ignore constants. We are going to look at these functions in terms of orders of magnitude. Does the function grow as n, n square, n cube, and so on? So one justification for this is because we are ignoring the notion of a basic operation, or rather we are being a bit vague about it. So let us look at an example. Right? So supposing we originally consider our basic operations to be assignments to variables or comparisons between variables. Now we decide that we will include swapping two values, exchanging the contents of x and y as a basic operation. Now, one of the first things we learn in programming is that in order to do this, we need to go via a temporary variable. So in order to exchange x and y in most programming languages, you have to first save x in a temporary variable, then copy y to x, and then restore y from the temporary variable. This takes 3 assignments. So if we take swap as a basic operation in our language, as compared to a calculation where we only look at assignments, we are going to collapse three assignments into one basic operation. So there is a factor of three difference between how we would account for the operations if we account for swap as a single operation. So in order to get away from worrying about these factors of three and two and so on, one important way to do this is to just ignore these constants when we are doing this calculation. So that's another motivation for only looking at orders of magnitude. So let us come back to this notion of worst case. So as we said, we are really looking at all inputs of size n, and among these inputs, which inputs drive the algorithm to take the maximum amount of time. So let's look for a simple algorithm here, which is looking for a value k in an unsorted array A. So in an unsorted array, we have no idea where the value k can be. So the only thing we can do is walk from beginning to end. Right? So we start by initializing this index I, which is a position to 0. And then we have a loop which says, so long as we have not found the array element, so long as ai is not k, we increment, right? We move to the next element. So this is the loop, and when we exit this loop, there are one or two possibilities. Either we have found the element, in which case I is less than n, or we have not found the element, in which case I has become n. So we check whether I is less than n. If I is less than n, then we have found it, okay? And if I is bigger than n, that means it is not found. Okay? So this is a simple algorithm. So now in this algorithm, the bottleneck is this loop, right? So this can take up to n iterations. Now when will it take n iterations? That is the worst case, right? So the worst case in this particular algorithm is it must go till the end either if the last element is k, or more generally if there is no copy of k in the array, right? If there is no k in the array, we have to scan all the elements to determine that k does not exist, right? So this becomes our worst case input. So it's important to be able to look at an algorithm and try to reconstruct what input would drive it to take the maximum amount of time. So in this simple case, this simple example, we can see that a case which forces us to execute the entire loop can be generated by choosing a value of k which is not in the array A. And in this case, therefore, the worst case is proportional to the size of the array n. But the crucial thing to remember is that in order to determine which is the worst case input, we have to understand the algorithm and look at it. We can't just blindly determine what is the worst case without knowing the problem at hand. With different algorithms, we have to come up with different worst cases depending on what the algorithm is supposed to do and how the algorithm is constructed. Okay, so the worst case input is a function of the algorithm itself. Now we could look at a different measure, right? So supposing we don't look at the worst case, we say, look at the average case. Right? So look at all possible inputs and then try to see how much time it takes on each of these inputs and somehow average it out, right? Now mathematically, in order to compute this kind of an average, we need to have a good way of estimating what are all the possible inputs to a problem. So although this sounds like a very attractive notion, in many problems it's very difficult. So supposing we are doing the airline route problem, right? How do we consider the space of all possible route maps, okay? And what is a typical route map and so on, right? So what are we going to average over? Are all these inputs equally likely? So we need to look at probabilities, and it's very often very difficult to estimate the probabilities of different types of inputs. So though it would make more sense from the point of view of the behavior of the algorithm in practical situations to look at the average case, that is, how does it behave over a space of inputs, in practice, it is very hard to do this because we cannot really quantify the space of possible inputs and assign them with meaningful probabilities. So to summarize, we look at worst case even though it could be unrealistic because the average case is hard, if not impossible, to compute. There are very limited situations where it is possible to do an average case analysis, but these are very, very rare. So the good thing about a worst case analysis is if we can prove a good upper bound, saying that even in the worst case, this algorithm performs efficiently, then we have got a useful piece of information about the algorithm. That is, it always works well. On the other hand, if we find out that this algorithm has a bad worst case upper bound, we may have to look a little further. How rare is this worst case? Does it often arise in practice? What type of inputs are worst case? Are they inputs that we will typically see? Are there any simplifying assumptions that we can make which will rule out these worst cases and so on. Okay? So though worst case analysis is not a perfect way of doing it, it is something which is mathematically tractable. It is something that we can kind of hope to compute. So that is one good reason for doing it, so that we can actually come up with a quantitative estimate. And secondly, it does give us some useful information, even though in some situations it may not be the most realistic situation that we are likely to come across in practice.